All right, we are recording. Got the right glasses on? I do.
Do I need to comb my hair?
Yeah, probably.
Good. Do not use this on camera or on the tape.
Oh, I definitely have to. You weren't switched on, unfortunately.
You are hereby prohibited.
Okay.
Do you need your beep?
No.
I don't think your beep's going to help.
This is being switched. It's not separate cameras. Not good. Separate recordings.
When are you going to be ready?
Shut up. Ham Radio Now, episode 140. You got to see why I'm laughing. This is why I'm laughing. Ham Radio Now, episode 145. We're still in 2 meters. Heading for Dayton. Going to talk to the guys at CQ. Welcome into the studio. Not sitting by the switcher in an unaccustomed position for him is my senior executive producer, Cliff Broughton, W4FT. Hello, Cliff.
Hello, Gary.
So we went to Dayton.
Yes,
did you have a good time?
Yes, I did. Took the long way around. Your trip was about 700 miles round trip. Mine was about 1,400. But then I was visiting relatives in Kentucky and Tennessee. So I met you there.
Do you have people admit to being relatives?
Yeah, more than you do.
That's true. So anyway, we ended up in Dayton. I need to explain to the audience a little bit about what this series is going to do. In the past, when I've done Dayton stuff, typically I would do an introduction on Friday, and then we'd shoot a bunch of stuff and make a Friday show out of it. And then we'd do the same thing on Saturday and Sunday if we could. This year, it's going to be a little bit different. Cliff and I shot a lot of stuff and ran around. In fact, we ran around like crazy. And you, as folks will see here and there in the programs as we produce them, carry the camera most of the time.
Yeah, my new job title is Sherpa. Yeah.
You did great, too. I didn't even have a hernia. I had no excuse for not doing any physical labor. It's just that you pulled the camera around. So.
Yeah, I did. Really wasn't that bad, but I'm still trying to understand.
Weather was terrible.
Oh, God. I actually got caught out in the hailstorm on Saturday.
The microphone has decided to float down. You have to crank that thing pretty tight.
Yeah, you need to buy a new stand here.
Yeah.
I think that'll hold.
Okay, there you go. So, the weather gets discussed in the program as well.
Yeah.
We did record an opening on Friday morning when we got set up out in the parking lot.
A very chilly Friday morning.
Yeah, and not going to really be able to use that opening because what I'm going to do this time, the way I'm going to produce this, is lots of relatively short individual segments. This was going to be one of those short individual segments, but it's not anymore.
No, it'll be on the outtake reel.
We're using up all this time. But they'll be short segments, 15, 20 minutes or so, not an hour. Some of the interviews that we did ran those 15 minutes. This one will be the talk with the CQ guys, who the big deal is they were there. I was very happy to see that they were there. That'll be a single one. The one that follows that is an interview with Flex. They've got a new product, the 6300, which they introduced sort of at Dayton. They announced it on email online a couple days before, but
it was pre-announced.
Yeah, but it hadn't been at any other shows,
right?
So that's cool. It's an inexpensive, relatively inexpensive Flex, real serious Flex radio, not the 5-watt version. You know, it's the full power and everything, but just a little bit cost reduced so that it's going to be a whole lot cheaper.
That's a better way to put it. For many hams out there, they'll look at it and say, that's way too much. But the guys that are into the high-end gear, they're going to look at that as a really good-priced version of the 6000 series.
Yeah, a $2,500 radio is now way too much. I mean, this radio behind me, which is rapidly getting long in the tooth, but it's an ICOM 756 Pro 3.
Yeah.
I really need to have you over here pushing the buttons. It's very distracting for me.
It's your idea, not mine.
Yeah. It was $3,000.
Yeah.
And it never got much cheaper than that, and its replacements are in that category. So.
Well, that seems to be a price point for that class of radio. 16 years ago, I bought a Yaesu FT-1000MP, and with the accessories I bought, which weren't much, a desk mic, a couple other odds and ends, that was a $3,000 radio back then. So today, upper-end radios for a lot of ham radio operators is in that price range. And in fact, at $2,500, it's probably a little below.
All right. So we're talking about the wrong segment because that isn't until the next.
We'll save that for next time.
Yeah, next program. So we did this introduction, and it won't be useful because we're not doing linear time progression throughout the program. Today's recording was made Sunday morning.
Yeah.
So, but I don't want to throw anything away. It was too good. So let's take a look at our introduction to Dayton, which won't really work as an introduction to Dayton. And then we'll get on to the CQ stuff. All right, here we go.
Press the button. It is now recording. So take your 10 seconds. Are you filming me?
Dum-de-dum, I'm filming you.
Oh, joy.
I can't clap.
Yay.
Bang.
Oh, you want to clap?
No,
here's a clap.
I don't want the clap. Ham Radio Now.
Cut.
Okay, Amy.
Yeah. Well, you forgot to remind me.
Oh, to level the camera?
Yeah, I looked at it and it's leaning.
No, and I wasn't shooting you screwing that up.
Yeah. Hang on.
Did you stop?
No, it's still rolling.
Okay. Let's make an interesting show.
Okay. Go ahead.
Ham Radio Now, episode, let's see, the last one was 144. So we're still in 2 meters, 145. If there's anything I've learned, it's sleep is overrated because I finished uploading F-144, all the ERA stuff at like 12:30, midnight. On Wednesday, and then up at 5 a.m. Thursday, driving 10 hours to Dayton with Cliff. Cliff, come around to the side of the camera for a second. Take off the headphones. Well, never mind. Actually, I've got you on camera. You're on the point of view cam.
Oh, boy.
And viewers of the previous Dayton episodes will remember the point of view cam. It's my little camera, handheld camera. We are standing in front of the iconic Hera Arena, so that means it must be time for the Dayton Hamvention. It is freaking cold out here, like 45 degrees, and I'm gathering a few raindrops on my little viewfinder, so the folks out here in the flea market are going to have a great day Friday morning. So we'll go inside, and we will spend the day nice and warm and cozy, and come out to the flea market tomorrow when the weather should be a little bit better, so on inside, and let's see what this year's 2014 Dayton Hamvention has to offer. We're hilarious.
Right.
And I'm giving you a lesson in how nonlinear television production is done. Because when we turned our heads to look at the screen, we saw nothing. You watched this episode a half hour ago when I played it over on the editing system. Yeah, but they don't know that.
This isn't my first rodeo.
This is television magic. This is behind the scenes. All right, so let's go back to Dayton now. This will be Sunday morning. You can see in the background that it's fairly quiet. The aisles are not jammed with people. On Friday and Saturday, the aisles were jammed with people.
Yeah.
But on a Sunday morning, it's when I'd like to do the more serious interviews because you can get people's attention a little bit better. It's quieter. You're not competing with people they're trying to do business with.
Trying to do business, trying to walk through the shots, trying to look at all the equipment we're standing in front of.
Yeah. Although,
trying to be at a ham fest.
Yep. Although, when they do business with people, they're doing business one, two, three at a time. Now, they're doing business as they appear on these programs with 3,000 people at once. Kaboom.
So, yeah.
maybe it's worth talking to the guys on camera.
Or at least 20 or 30 anyway.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. All right. So back on down to Dayton and see the guys from CQ. Pretend you're looking over the monitor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Synchronizing the cameras in 3, 2, 1. Bip. Very technical. You know how that technical stuff goes in television. So, Rich, I was saying before we, when I came by the booth on Friday, that I was glad to see you here. And you said...
We're glad to be here. And it's been a very gratifying weekend for us. The has cemented my long-held knowledge that hams are the greatest people in the world. The amount of support and understanding that we've had from everyone we've talked to has been marvelous as we've explain to them what's been happening with us and where we're going and how we're getting things back on track. And everyone has been absolutely wonderful.
So most of the mud balls that got thrown seem to have been online where people, they weren't all anonymous. A lot of people had their call signs and stuff like that, but that's where there's some separation. The folks you've seen here in person haven't been quite that way.
That's correct. They've been great.
So I do have to do some journalistic due diligence. You've been in the journalism business now for your whole career, one side or another. The most difficult question I can ask, and you're not obligated to answer, is, was it a problem you just couldn't pay bills, couldn't pay the printer, couldn't pay postage?
It's a very difficult economy right now, and very difficult time for the publishing industry, and things are very, very tight. We've had to make some changes in order to be able to keep things going. We've consolidated Popular Communication, CQ VHF, and World Radio Online into CQ Plus, which Richard is editing, which is an expanded digital edition of CQ. We've been getting really, really high marks on that from people here. And so, as with any small business that's facing a rough patch, you make the changes that you need to make in order to get things back on track and moving in the right direction again.
Do you think you waited too long trying to keep the other magazines going as independent magazines? Is that might have hurt things harder or worse than they might have if you'd made those tough calls earlier?
With 20/20 hindsight, most likely, yes. We did see the writing on the wall, and we kept hoping things would get better, and they didn't. So would we have been in better shape if we had made the decisions that we made 3 or 4 months earlier? Yes. But we tried to hang on with them as long as we could. And did it hurt us? Yes. Fortunately, all the changes that we're making are bringing things back into line. Most people that we've talked to here have gotten their May issue already, or they'll be waiting for them when they get home.
That's the print version.
Yes. The digital version.
Now let me check the calendar. Yes, it's still May.
It is still May, and not the end of May either. We're getting closer, and we hope that by this summer we'll be back on regular schedule with the print edition.
So the speculation, of course, is going to fold, going to go away. I don't know that you can ever make a long-term guarantee, but what's our short-term prognosis?
Short-term prognosis is very good. We're getting our act back together and getting back on schedule. Magazines are out there, and we're plugging along.
What you got to worry about when something like this happens is it's going to scare away people who would subscribe for the magazine ordinarily, but they're going to say, well, am I going to be losing my money? It's not like it's that much money, but, you know, hams are hams. Hams are cheap. So have you had to deal with that very much, or are you getting the opposite, where people are saying, I'm going to invest in this?
What we've been seeing here at the show in particular has been what your second thing you said. People have been exceedingly supportive. They've been renewing their subscriptions, often for multiple years, talking about how much they like the magazine and want to make sure that it continues to be here and that they'll do their part to help.
All right. Richard, you are now digital only. How's that working for you?
Fine. We have taken the best elements of Popcom and CQVHF and World Radio Online and consolidated them into the digital CQ Plus. And it's very much like putting out a a paper magazine. It's formatted in the same way. So people who look at it digitally are going to see the same type pages they see in CQ and what were the pages in the other magazines. So,
I mean, do you wish you were still printing a full Popular Communications, or are you being able to do the serious stuff that you really wanted to be able to do anyway?
Oh, well, of course we would want to. We hated to close down those magazines, all three of them. But, and you know, they're legacy publications for this company, so it was not an easy decision. But I think we've come to the best of all worlds in a very difficult situation in the consolidation into CQ Plus. So, and frankly, CQ VHF, for example, was a quarterly magazine. Now we're shooting for having elements of CQ VHF in every edition of CQ Plus, which means they'll get some CQ VHF copy in all 12 months of the year. So, there are pluses and minuses on both sides, but like Rich said, the reaction has been very positive, so that's gratifying for us.
So for either of you guys, now it is no longer purely a decision of, do I want the print, do I want digital, or maybe do I want both? You have to go digital if you want the full thing. What kind of reaction are you getting to that?
Well, we're still providing a choice to particularly the traditional CQ reader, who has the choice of CQ in print, which has what CQ has always had, and everything. There's nothing less in CQ than there ever has been, or the option of the digital edition, which includes everything that's in CQ, plus all the other material, another 60, 70 pages a month of great material on the broader aspects of the hobby. So if you're looking for specifically for the material that used to be in PopCom or CQVHF or World Radio Online, then the economic reality is that, yes, that's only available digitally. If you're looking for the content that has traditionally been in CQ, then you have a choice. You can still get it in print, or you can get it in digital, and the bonus that you get if you go with the digital edition is that you also get all this other great copy too.
Okay, so you do have that choice, but we're being, and it's not what you wanted to do, but it's what you had to do if you want the extra stuff. It is just going to be digital, and for those that really resist that, that's where we're stuck.
It's an unfortunate fact of life at the moment. I mean, it's not just us. You know, monitoring times went away. The National Communications Magazine that was put out by the Bearcat Club, I believe, has gone away. The state of the listening hobby right now is such that, unfortunately, it cannot support even one print publication, let alone three. It's sad because it's a wonderful part of this whole hobby, but it's the way it is, and none of us can afford to invest thousands and thousands of dollars every year in something that doesn't bring back the return on that investment.
Yeah. And Richard, that in particular has to bother you some. They're testing the PA system, because that's been your focus. Scanning and shortwave listening has been your main focus. My local police department is switching from analog to digital, and one of the guys in the radio crew has told me that it is going to be encrypted for the police side, not the fire side, not the EMS side, but the police side. Right. So that, it's going to be more of a problem for me personally, but how widespread does that seem to be becoming?
Well, it's growing, of course, because the encrypted technology is becoming more and more affordable and available to municipalities. So it seems to be moving that way. But one thing we recognize is that vacant airwaves don't stay vacant forever. So something is going to fill that void. and we're excited to see where it's going.
Well, that would be on the HF and shortwave side, as the shortwave stations drop off. Yeah, what's going to appear? And that's an area to explore, I think. Tell me a little bit more about that, because it's like, what signals are going to be there? Would they be more interesting to try to find?
That's the exciting thing. We don't know where it's headed. And in fact, I was talking to our technology editor about that here, and we're going to try to keep an eye on it to see where it's trending in the coming months and year or so or whatever. But you're right. I mean, the frequencies are being vacated, and something is going to appear there. So, and we're hoping to bring that news first to our readers.
Yeah, and whether it's something created by a government or something a bit more clandestine, they want you to listen.
That's right. And those pirates are out there. I mean, they'll grab those frequencies in a heartbeat. So,
you know, it's not going to be as easy to get started with shortwave listening today. You're not going to have the voice of Russia, or which used to be Radio Moscow when we were growing up, or Radio Canada, which were powerhouses that any beginning shortwave listener could tune into. But there's a lot of smaller operations out there that you might not have been able to tune in because of the powerhouse stations, that now, with some diligent tuning and maybe some antenna skullduggery, that you can suddenly have the opportunity to listen to. And it becomes a big challenge to try to find these stations. And that's what we're going to be helping with, letting people know what's out there, where to find it, how to find them.
And do you expect to be covering the transition, the changes that are going, as a sort of an editorial thing? I mean, telling people, sorry, you're not going to be able to hear your local police department?
Well, actually, we are such a broad-based publication, it would be impossible, I think, for us to keep a running log of what people are changing back and forth to and from.
Maybe not your local police department, but in general.
Absolutely. The trends, of course, in scanning, that's one of our responsibilities. So, yes, we'll be covering that, as well as HF, shortwave, even VLF. So the whole spectrum.
All right. Well, once again, I am very happy to see this great big CQ hanging here. I don't know if I was right to wonder if it would be there. A few months ago, I was wondering. As we talked after that, it became clearer and clearer that wouldn't be a problem. But I'm very glad to see it here. So thanks for
being here. And again, our gratitude to our readers is without bounds. They have just been so wonderful to us. And it is our plan to keep giving them what they're looking for month after month, as we have been for 70 years now. We're coming up on our 70th birthday.
It's got to be feeling a little bit old. You're back doing
it? I'm not 70 years old.
Yeah, you didn't start it. So, and to leave completely the arena of any kind of political correctness, is there anybody out there you want to give a raspberry to?
No.
Just the camera?
Not at all.
He's way too polite. How about you, Richard?
Not at all. We love everybody.
I don't know what I'm going to do with you guys. I'll do it for you. All right, all you guys. Where'd I put it? That's still... Oh, there it is. There's my... the May edition of CQ. I got a little camera I can show that to you on. It's a little dark. So it says May 2014, and as Rich promised, it was in my mailbox when I got back. Do you subscribe to CQ?
I've had a subscription to the digital edition, but I've been cutting back on all my subscriptions because I'm getting ready to move.
It will move with you, especially the digital one. You don't even have to give them a forwarding address.
Well, there is that, yeah.
So, anyway, I'm enjoying digital. I'm still getting the stuff in the mail. I had the print subscription for a long time, and I subscribed to VHF, CQ VHF, and to PopCom.
Yeah.
So, I don't have my library here. What was left of those got tacked on to the main CQ print edition. So I'll get those for another couple of months.
Right.
And then off they go. So I'm glad that they're still around. This one, though, this is going to be sort of a, I'm looking at the wrong one.
A collector's item?
Yeah, this one that says March, April on it. That's probably going to be kind of special. I'll probably hang on to that for a while. You won't see very many like that. At least I hope we don't see very many like that. So did you buy anything at Dayton?
Well, I had a shopping list for a friend. Picked up an MFJ tuner for them. But for myself, no, not really. I've been doing this, I've been a ham for, 16, 17 years. And like I said, I'm trying to get my house ready to sell and move. So I'm actually trying to get rid of everything I can. I cannot believe the stuff I accumulated over a decade. So everything's just kind of on hold until I relocate and replace the radio.
Where are you moving to?
Probably Southern California.
Yep. Did you move? The camera's not... A camo looks terrible again.
Oh, I moved. I moved.
You're not supposed to move because you lost all your headroom.
Yeah.
Sit still. Sit up. This is television.
No.
Well, see, the problem is Cliff is my floor director. He's the one who wags his finger at people when they get to the wrong positions.
And failed to use the microphone.
Yeah, and now you're not being the floor director, you're being talent. So no one is here to tell you that you've...
And that's a very generic term.
...screwed things up. So one last thing that is I want to talk about is the stuff that we did before we went to Dayton. And I rushed to get online. I rushed so fast to get it online, I didn't even have any of the publicity out. It didn't have the website up or anything. And that was our space station contact.
The Aeris stuff.
Yeah, you came down to coastal, I'll call it coastal North Carolina.
Yeah, we found our way down there eventually.
Yes, GPS was not our friend.
Yeah, technology should be vetted before it's used.
Yeah. But what happened was we were using the Street Atlas, which I run on, I run in my car on a little computer. You've seen that on previous videos. Trying to find a school that was on the other side of Camp Lejeune. So we get down there and we're driving along and we realize we've gone past the turn and we went back to find where the turn was, and the turn that Street Atlas was trying to get us to make was a two-rut road.
Onto a road that's onto the military base, and it was closed.
Yeah, great big barrier across it. And so we were like way in the wrong place. But fortunately, we had left ourselves plenty of time. So we got there in plenty of time.
Yeah. See, the part he's not telling you is every time I get in that car and use his GPS technology,
we go the wrong way.
We go the wrong way. I don't know what it is, but every time we use his, we go the wrong way. So I get mine out. I bring my GPS along. Get there every time.
Yes. Well, we made it home from Dayton.
Yes, we did.
Kind of knew the way.
Yeah, that and the fact that you were driving your car and I was driving mine.
Yep. So anyway, and we had fun on the way back.
Oh, yeah.
We were playing on HF. You'll see some of that in upcoming programs. But
yeah.
Cliff would get a little bit out of 2 meter range, about 10 to 15 miles in front of me, and we played with 80 meters and 40 meters and 60 meters.
Briefly,
and yeah, it kind of surprised me that how well all three of those worked at that distance. Would have expected to be out of direct range, certainly out of 2 meter range. Some ground wave capability. I don't know, maybe somebody out there can tell us, were we getting any sky wave advantage at 15 miles apart on those bands on a late fall, midday to early afternoon?
No.
I'm not sure.
More like early spring than late fall. Or late spring, excuse me.
Did I say fall?
You said fall.
It's got nothing to do with fall. It's one of those weird things where I knew what word wanted to say, but
and it seemed like we did better when we were about 5 or 6 miles apart. We did better. We started on 40 or?
Started on 60.
Yeah, we started on 60 and went to
40.
Then your
antenna didn't work so good.
Yeah, we'll talk about that in a second. We started on 60, went to 40, sounded a little better. Then got further apart, switched to 80, and sounded even better, didn't it?
I think so.
Yeah.
I didn't record all of it, and I didn't take scrupulous notes. So
neither did I. I was too busy trying to drive down the road.
Yeah. So anyway, we did have a good time, and I've got a little bit of video of that. Especially the fun one is as I drive into a tunnel, trying to get you to keep talking.
No, who do you want to talk?
Yeah. I've got a tunnel. I'm going 60 miles an hour toward a tunnel, and I'm trying to get Cliff. And well, we was talking to Cliff and my father-in-law, Mac, W4PBT. We're on 40 meters.
And he was in Charlotte.
Yeah. And so I'm heading for this tunnel. It's like the space station. We're not going to stop. I could have stopped, but I wasn't going to. I was on, you know, Interstate 77.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, traffic all around me. I'm not going to be slamming on the brakes. And I'm telling these guys, talk so I can record you as I'm driving into the tunnel. And Cliff says, which one of us do you want to talk? And I got the microphone down in my lap at this point because I've got a camera and I'm trying to drive. I just all, talk!
There's the little detail of complete instructions.
Yeah. And so on the other end of the tunnel, I'm hoping they're still talking. And I come out of the tunnel, the signals come up. You'll hear this on the video when we play it. Coming up in a future episode of Ham Radio Now, so stay tuned. And I'm saying, I hope that my uncooperative HF station, you'll hear this, I say it right under the camera, my uncooperative HF stations are still talking. And I come out and I get three words from you. Something like, I wonder if he's still in the tunnel. And you stop. Then you start up again. No, I don't hear him. I guess he's still. You give him books, they eat the covers. So what I really wanted to talk about was this Aeris thing. It's not getting as many views as I think it should. Yeah. We're not up to 1,000 yet. And I'm not sure why that is, other than that ran to Dayton without giving it any publicity. No website, nothing on QRZ. I just did that in this past week when I should have been putting this program together. I had to do the publicity for Aeris. So maybe that's some of it, but some of it is like, I just kind of wonder, are people thinking it's just another Aeris contact?
Well, another piece of it might also be that everybody's focused on Dayton.
Well, that's true.
Give it another week. See what happens.
As I said, as I introduced the program, oh, great. I'm putting this out just as 25,000 of the most active, engaged ham radio operators in the country and many from around the world are all going to be in the same place, not watching any online television. So yeah, so we'll see. That may be part of it, but I kind of wonder, you know, there's 1,000 Aeris contacts out there, and this one is not one of those.
Yeah,
this one is, well, it's four programs long.
Yes, it was. And it was a lot of fun to do, and it was a lot of fun and useful to get the input after the fact from the people that put it together.
Yeah, so that's what we did. We got the contact itself is in part one of episode 144. And it's, if you haven't watched that yet, it's done the way we do things at Ham Radio Now. Three cameras, good audio, just absolutely spectacular. Then we went down there a week later because I wanted to talk to these people, and you can't do it the day of the contact. Everything is chaotic afterwards. It's noisy and the media, the nasty old media is busy rounding up everybody and getting interviews. So we went down there a week later and we talked to the kids, two of the kids,
yeah,
and their teacher and the ham and the public information officer. And that made two more programs. The kids part of the interview is particularly good. I think Cindy and I watched some of that. Cindy actually just sat there watching. She wanted to go to bed. She was ready to go to bed. We just watched a movie, and I just stuck that up on the Chromecast, on the big screen TV off the YouTube, and she just sat there watching it for a while because the kids were great. So
yeah, they were.
Go back and watch those shows, and then come back and watch the rest of these. But I guess I'm saying I put too many programs online. Maybe that's the problem. One a month would be more like it.
Yeah, pacing's nice, but like a lot of people have said, maybe shorten them up a little or break them up into parts.
Well, this was going to be a short program, but as you can see, that's why it's not.
This is going to be a short full hour and a half. Yep.
Yep. The other thing that I wanted to mention about that, though, is people have complained about the headphones. I even stuck that on a previous show where John Dvorak complaining about the cans on the big microphone and all that stuff. So if you notice on the interviews on the Aris, down in part two and part three, my headphones are lying on the table. There was a consequence for that. The consequence is one of the microphones was practically turned off. The one that was sitting in front of Frank, W4UOR, the other ham.
Yeah.
If he doesn't sound like he's on mic on a beautiful, expensive Heil microphone sitting right in front of him, if it sounds more like he's talking from the other side of the room, it's because his microphone was turned down. And because I wasn't wearing the headphones, couldn't hear it.
Yeah, well,
the meters were bouncing. The meters always bounce.
Oh, yeah.
But these, wrong camera. There we go. These meters here. Yeah, you can sort of see these meters bouncing down here. But they always bounce. They don't tell you whether the sound is good. They just tell you that it's present.
Yeah. Well, I'll take part of the blame for that because while you were sitting there without the cans,
I
always wear them. But the problem is that my hearing in my left ear is gone.
Which is why you've got no earphone in your left ear. It's just stuck in your right ear.
And that's, I believe that microphone was on the left channel.
Could have been.
And on the right channel, everything sounded fine.
Yeah. So... All right. Well, I think we're done. Thank you for coming to Dayton with me.
It was fun.
And for coming down to Aris with me. Jeff, who has normally been to doing the Dayton stuff, wanted to play Hamfest. He was there. You'll see him on an upcoming, one of the many, many upcoming. One of the advantages of doing this as multiple programs is my episode count is going to go through the roof.
Yeah. Are you going to do these as part A, B, C, and
D? No. No, 145, 146, 147. I'm going to catch up in there with Ham Nation and then sail on past, baby.
Not going back to the old days, huh?
Well, I've done both. I mean, the Aris one was episode 144, parts A, B, C, D, or 1, 2, 3. I don't know how right. Whatever nomenclature, I forget. And part four is 1992 Cerex Contact. I watched that again. I've watched that a billion times because I made it back in 1992. It's awesome. It's really fun to watch.
Oh, yeah.
Or at least I think so because I made them. I don't know.
They are.
I'm no judge of my own stuff. Hard to say. All right, so you've seen CQ. Coming up next will be Flex. I've got everything is now in the... One of the things that takes a long time in between shooting some massive project like this and starting to get things out is that I'm a tedious, methodical editor. So we've got lots of these short shots, short interviews, short B-roll shots, and I catalog and name every one of them so I know what I've got. And in Hollywood, editors have assistant editors. I've got a senior executive producer. What I need is a junior assistant editor who will catalog all these things and show me what they are. But I don't think I'd want to do it that way because then I would have names, but I wouldn't know what the pictures are.
You wouldn't know the content.
Yeah. So I do that, and that took several days. And now that I've got all that done, actually putting these things together and popping them out will be fairly efficient. And I will not be inviting you over to participate in the introductions to each one. Some of them I won't even bother with introductions. Some of them you'll just see the title fly in and the thing will start and off it will
go. You can give a 10-second introduction.
Maybe. I doubt if I can do that. That's not in me. There's too much in me. Yeah. Better off if I don't even try. So anyway, that's all coming up. Hopefully very soon. There's other stuff out there. Things don't stop happening just because I'm busy editing a whole dump truck load of videos from a big ham fest like Dayton. other things keep happening.
The yes, they do.
Skype beckons. So yeah. May have to stick some other stuff in there too. I don't know. We'll see.
Well, I'll just be glad when you get caught up on all your editing.
That's never going to happen. I can't tell you how much. I've got stuff from 3 years ago I haven't edited yet.
NASA.
That I want to put on there. Well, that's not a Ham Radio Now program. But it's... Oh. This tape here is what he's talking about. Space One Cliff. And that was from Orlando...
Two years ago.
After Orlando was done, we took Monday off and went down to the space station, what do they call
Kennedy
it?
Kennedy Space Center.
Yeah. Cape Canaveral. It's Cape Canaveral again. It wasn't for a while, right?
The locals got very upset about that. It's the Kennedy Space Center at Cape Canaveral. It's not Cape Kennedy.
Okay.
But we went down there, and the idea was to take a lot of pictures, shoot a lot of video for ourselves, and bring it back and pool our resources together. Well, I'm still waiting for the raw footage.
Yeah, you'll get it.
But it was worth the trip. We actually got in there, went through the vertical assembly building while they were servicing one of the shuttles.
You call it the vertical assembly building, but the science is a vehicle assembly building.
Both terms are used.
Okay.
It's definitely not the horizontal assembly building.
Well, that's true because it's hugely tall.
The VAB, when they had the doors open just right, has its own cloud formations indoors. So it's huge building inside. And that was actually the first time I've ever been in that building, despite having worked a summer down there at Kennedy Space Center. I got lucky. I had a summer job as a co-op, and I was there for the rollout of STS-3. So it was fun to go back and see the things that I had seen before, but I'm still waiting for the video.
And maybe I will put it up. It won't be a Ham Radio Now program, but I've got other venues on YouTube that I can stick things up, and I'll let you know.
Cool.
When it goes up. All right, let's get this puppy wrapped up and off to the next one, which will be Flex, which I've already talked about. We won't have to do much of an introduction for that.
Yeah, well, we'll go back over all that again.
But we have to say goodbye. So I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. What are my titles?
Talent.
Producer, editor, host. You are?
Cliff Broughton, W4FT, senior executive producer now.
And schlep.
Cameraman.
Schlep.
Schlepper.
Chief Schlep.
Sherpa. Chief cook and bottle washer.
I don't have enough room in the lower third title to put all that stuff in there. Uh-huh. So, and I get to say over, and you get to say?
And out.